Good afternoon. My name is Jim Conlan and welcome to the latest episode of our entertainment show. As you know, in season one, we did a special premiere 2 years ago on the A-Team about guest actors and actresses that appeared on the A-Team. We had the Bad Guys documentary and we had the Good Guys documentary. And we're back now for another special feature on the A-Team 2 years later to celebrate that success with a special interview there this evening on that sort of hit TV show. And I'm delighted to be joined by the one and only Marla Heasley. If you start to recognize that name, Marla Heasley, Marla Heasley appeared in 10 episodes of The A-Team. She appeared of what people don't know is she appeared of them in 9 episodes as Tawnia Baker. But the very first episode she appeared on The A-Team, she appeared as a different character altogether. She appeared as Cherise in season 2, episode 4 of Bad Time on the Border, October the 18th, 1983. So she actually did a guest star appearance while Melinda Cooley was actually on the show of the A-Team as such. And Marla, first of all, the A-Team, I suppose before we delve deep into it, when you start to look back in it now, sort of, oof, are we talking, we're talking nearly 40 years at this stage now in terms right. of that. It's a very sort of long time. Does it almost feel like it's surreal that it didn't happen that time of your life? Do you start to think to yourself, well, did that actually happen? Or are there some days where you can start to close your eyes and lie down and relax and all of a sudden you're back there again?
No, I never don't remember it happening. It was very, very prominent in my life. And it was a really wonderful time in my life. So I can remember it. I mean, there's details that I don't remember. I mean, I was watching some of your videos and some, you know, other people were saying that they couldn't remember. I think I can remember a little bit more than some, but because it was so prominent, and when you're younger, you remember things more than when you're older. I remember more then than I do now. So, but it was really a wonderful time in my life, and I'm so grateful for that time. It was just a great time. It was really a wonderful time.
And I suppose, Marla, everyone knows you for the Tawnia Baker role, but obviously you tried out, first of all, for the A-Team for a guest appearance role as the character Cherise in season 2. Had you tried out in season 1 in terms of guest roles and guest actresses, or was this your very first audition for the A-Team, the season 2 episode of Cherise? And how did that turn around? Is there a good story behind that? Was that sort of touch and go? Had you to go through numerous auditions, or were you sort of recommended for the role?
So Cherise, I read for. It was a very small part. I had done, that was my first part working for Stephen Cannell. And then I got called back. I never worked for him before. I never read for him before or read for, at the time I read for John Ashley, who was one of the producers. And so I had not read for them before. Then I got called back for, it wasn't really Melinda Calais' replacement because they didn't want it to be called that, but the new girl on the show. And so I got called back for that. And I think I had, oh gosh, I read for John, and then I got a call back to read again for John. And Stephen Cannell and some other people. And then I think altogether I had 4 interviews, I believe. And then it went to, I went to the network to read for the network for Brandon Tartikoff and other people of the network. And it's funny because I had not watched the show before I had actually read the part. I saw the show when I did Cherise, but to watch the whole series, I really wasn't. And I remember speaking to my brother and he was like, oh, please get that show. It's my favorite show. I'm like, really? Because I haven't watched it. But I was very nervous the day I was supposed to read for the network. I was fine before, but when it went to reading for the network, I was just, oh my gosh, I was shaky. And then they canceled that day. They said that they're not going to have the reading till the next day. And it's funny because thank God they did. I was so nervous that morning when I woke up to read that by the next day, I was fine. I was actually fine. I wasn't nervous at all. In fact, the casting director, Ruben Cannon was his name. And when he was reading, his paper was shaking. He was reading the lines off the sides, which are the papers, and his hands were shaking. And I wanted to just like touch him and say, it's okay. I'm the one getting the part. So, but I was on eggshells and I was incredibly happy that I got the part because there were a lot of girls reading for that.
And I suppose, Marla, in terms of Melinda's departing the show, and obviously it's well reported and it's well speculated that there was an awful lot of friction between Melinda and George Peppard towards the end, and it's bitter to say the least. And George Peppard wasn't sort of too keen, let it behold, of finding a replacement for Melinda. He almost felt like the show could go on without that. So were you sort of a bit, did you hear that? Did you hear the rumblings that were going on? And were you a bit nervous approaching George Peppard for the first time? Or what was your interaction with George like that very first meeting?
You know, I did not know about the rumblings. I didn't know that there was a problem until John Ashley drove me to the set one day before I started working for me to meet everybody. And on the way in the car, he told me about what was going on with Melinda and how George, what John said was that she, I guess, cut her hair while they were filming. And they did not like that she cut her hair, that she had long hair before and she cut it short. And they didn't like that when she had come back, I think for the next season, that her hair was short. They wanted her to be more of a girl. Then look, you know, to them, she didn't look as much girlish. They wanted, you know, it was the '80s. They wanted the girl. And so they also said, he also told me to not to pay any mind to George, but just not to let him bother me, because George was just not happy about a girl being on the show. So he did warn me about George on the drive there. And I think it was in Santa Clarita that we were driving to from Los Angeles. And so he did warn me about George. And that did scare me a little bit. It wasn't until I actually met George on the set the first day that I was working that frightened me. And I've told this story before, but it's he just pretty much told me that he did not want a girl on the show and that I had to work really hard to keep up with them. And he said, it's nothing against you. He said, it has nothing against you at all. He said, it's any girl that would be on our show as a series regular. He said, I just don't feel, and the guys don't feel, that a girl is needed on the show. So, and you know what? I was just so happy to have this job and to be on the show and be working. It was so much fun that after the first week of working, George watched everything I did, every scene I did, he watched. And after the first week, he couldn't have been nicer. He was really a good guy. He bought me a Christmas present, as he did everybody on all the cast. He was just really nice. He would call me baby. Hi, baby. But
so you won him over?
No, I don't know about that. I think he just wanted me to know that I had to work hard and that he was pretty much boss.
And I suppose, Marla, it's important to know that I spoke to Dwight Schultz, and he told me that he was telling me that story, and he told me in terms of that it was coming from George, and himself and Dirk had no sort of ill feelings towards any woman being on the show, and they were actually Dwight said that he actually enjoyed your company in terms of being on the show. So I say that Dwight and Dirk were way more open to the possibility of you coming on.
Oh, that's good to know. Thank you. That's good to know. I actually love them. They're great. I had so many laughs with them. I mean, the whole cast and the crew were a blast. We laughed all the time. They were really fun.
And I suppose George, as we know, was a terrific actor, one of the best, wonderful comedian actors, different genres as well. And I suppose, did you even notice the friction between himself and Mr. T? Obviously, another sort of friction that was there, because Mr. T was just into the wrestling entertainment sort of industry, and George felt that sometimes as Mr. T was getting more recognition than he was, and for the A-team and stuff like that. And there was a tiny bit of friction there in terms of, well, he was supposed to be the main lead. Did you notice that sort of jealousy that was there?
Yes, it was always underlined. It was always there underlined. George, you know, would say little comments. Mr. T would sometimes say little comments, not as much as George. It was more George. I remember, I guess it was the last day of the first season I was on. It was before I was let go, because I didn't know I was being let go until after that season was over. They brought me back for the opening, but that was it. So it was the last day we were wrapping. And George had bought beer for the whole crew, cast, everyone. And so he got on top of some orange, what are those boxes? I can't even think right now, but he stood on top of a crate, a box crate, and made a toast. And the start of the toast was being the star of this show. And
was
then
he sober
he
at
to
the
make
time?
The toast. Pardon?
Was he sober at the time?
Yes, he was. Yeah. He actually made a toast, not with a beer. He wasn't drinking. He was not allowed to drink. He actually, I think it was in his contract that he was not allowed to drink while he was on the show. So he made a toast, not with beer, with something else, but he made a toast to everybody to thank them for the season, that season. But it started out with being the star of the show. So it was kind of, you know, no one said anything, but, you know, inside I was laughing.
And I suppose, Marla, onto the more funnier times on the A-team as well. First of all, the stunts team on the A-team. Wow, wow, wow. Probably one of the best in the business in the 80s. And you were involved in many sort of stunts. You got involved in many sort of car scenes as well. And how did you start? I remember one episode, it was the general, they were changing guns down to the warehouse. And you were you were stopping up this general that had murdered a girl's daughter. And so you were trying to court him driving back and forth. Yeah. You were doing a race against each other. If you start to remember that sort of
I remember
scene.
That.
And what was driving that Corvette in the stunts team? Did you have a stunt double doing those sort of scenes, or was that yourself?
No, I drove a little bit, just, you know, but not really. I mean, it was mostly the stunt team, but I did drive that car. But wasn't really driving. I believe it was on a truck that was pulling it with the camera to my side. So, so I was in the car, but I wasn't really driving. I was pretending like I was driving. But the stunt team was amazing. They were so good. We had the best stunt people on our show. And they were a blast as well. They were funny. Oh my gosh, these guys were funny. And I did have a stunt double, but not as often as the guys. The guys had more stunt doubles than I did.
And Marla, your first interaction, I can't remember, is when you're introduced to the Face Man character. The first time Templeton Peck, and Templeton is trying on his charms with you, and you're sort of aware, you've been told by Amy Allen what this so you'd sort of know how to sort of resist him in such.
I'm sorry, I missed some of that.
No, the first time that you were introduced to the Faceman, Timpledin character, and he's not aware of your sort of background, and he started coming on to you in terms of making your moves, and you should mention the word commitment to him, the background, and you sort of scared the living daylights out of him as such. That sort of interaction the first time with him.
He was great. He was actually great. And that was a really fun scene. And that actually, I think that was my first day of filming when it was later on in the script, but that scene was, I believe, my first day of filming. And that's when he gets thrown out the window. Right. So it was a lot of fun. He made me laugh. Some of the ways he would say his lines would just crack me up. Dirk's a great guy. He's a really nice guy. It was a lot of fun interacting with him and all of them, but that was a fun day. That was my very first day of filming, and that was a lot of fun that day.
And Marla, Dwight Schultz, Howling Mad Murdoch, a fantastic theater actor, as we know, he brought that to the set of the A-Team. The up and sort of downs, the change of characters, the off the wall sort of nuttiness. When you're behind the screen, you're behind the camera, when you're seeing Dwight doing that, do you always come reclined to how good it is? Do you like take it as normal as, oh, that's Dwight at work again? Or do you say, how can he do this sort of off the wall sort of nuttiness that he was able to, but be such a well-rounded, smart, sophisticated guy, very, very clever, and probably the most intellectual guy on the set of the A-Team?
I was in awe of Dwight. He is such a good actor. They would change his lines last minute, and he would have, you know, this long monologue. Often he had lots of monologues, and they would change it last minute, and he would just get it. And he was just always great. He was always on top of it. He was amazing. I was always in awe of him. I mean, it was never, oh, that's just Dwight. I was just always like, wow, he's amazing. He was really good. Always, he still is. I mean, he's a great actor.
And Marla, most of your scenes were in the A-Team were mostly with either Dirk Benedict or Dwight Schultz. Did you have much interactions? Have you any memories with Mr. T in terms of special sort of scenes, or off the set, did you get to interact with Mr. T? And how did you find him? Was he a very sort of conservative man in terms of, did he keep to himself?
He kept to himself. He's so nice and so kind and really sweet, and he's also funny. They were all funny, but he was mostly in his trailer. He kept to himself. He prayed a lot. He's very faithful, and he's a born again Christian. And he would be in his trailer a lot, listening to religious or evangelical tapes or, you know, audio recordings. But he did keep to himself. I didn't spend a lot of time with T except on the set. But he was always really, really nice and funny. He was amazing with kids. He was so good with kids. When kids would come to the set or if they wanted his autograph, he was so good. He's just a good guy, really good guy.
And Marla, in terms of the A-Team, obviously you were there for a season. You first arrived in there in terms of playing the Tawnia Baker role in September. It was like two months afterwards in 1984, January the 10th, 1984, The Battle of Bel Air was your first episode. And in September the 25th, 1984 was sort of your last episode. You were roughly 9 months roughly with that sort of Tawnia Baker character. Did it come obvious to you towards the end, towards season three, episode three, when you were in season three, you were in the third episode, did you feel you were going to finish out season three? Or did you feel that maybe that's rumblings are on the wall, that they didn't want to continue with this character, that they wanted to go on a different line?
So the last the season. Well, season three is I opened season three, didn't I?
You did, The Bend in the River Part
Two. So I knew then that was the end. I mean, that was the end of me. They married me off. The end of season two, I did not know at all until we were on hiatus. And I was told by my agents that they were not bringing me back, but they were going to bring me back for a two-hour goodbye show. And so that's how I found out from my agents during hiatus that I was not coming back.
Was that difficult for you to take, knowing that you're coming back to a show for a two-hour sort of shoot, a two-hour episode, and that was it in terms of that your contract was that even though a season three was going ahead, that you were not going to be part of it? Was that hard to film for you?
Well, you know, George did tell me from the beginning, from day one, that they didn't want a girl. So George actually said to me, he came to me when we were filming my last 2 hour episode. He took me aside and he said, I told you, you know, I'm sorry, but I did tell you that we did not want a girl. He said, it had nothing to do with you. He said, you were very professional, but we got our way and we got our wish. So it made me sad, absolutely, because I loved working on the show. I was incredibly happy working on that show, but it is what it is. That's the business. You never know. And I was told. So there's nothing you can do. I mean, if I had, you know, if I was Bewitched, Samantha on Bewitched, and I can wiggle my nose, I would have stayed on the show, but obviously not.
And Marla, before I bring you back now to the final two questions of the A team, I know it's a busy time for you at the moment. You're delving in sort of projects. You might enlighten our audience on some of the projects that are in the works, or maybe TV appearances or other professional entitlements that you're working on at the moment.
Sure. No TV appearances, but I am writing a book and I'm almost done. I had some health issues. I went back to school. I became a nutritional health coach. And so I'm writing a book on my journey through health, through my autoimmune issues, and how diet and frame of mind can change things. So it's about my journey and helping others on their journey to be healed and to get well and to get better. It being happy as well.
And what a thought-provoking story. We wish you all the best with that project. We wish you all the success with it, Marla. Marla, just in terms of your Tawnia Baker character now, let's pretend there was an A-Team encyclopedia and they went through every sort of character, fictional character in the A-Team, and they came down to T and they came to Tawnia Baker. And under a synopsis, they left two blank sentences in terms of summarizing her up. And they got onto your talent agent, got onto you, and they asked, Marla, will you write those two sentences to describe what type of person Tawnia Baker was? What would you like those two sentences to read?
Oh gosh, she was incredibly grateful to be part of the A-Team. She was in awe of them, which showed actually in the very first episode, where, you know, she was trying to get to be a part of them. She was incredibly grateful to be with them and working with them. And she was just a good girl.
And Marla Heasley, the final question for you now, is there any particular story or memory, a funny moment, a blooper, an interaction with one of the guest stars, whether it was on set, off set, that's special to you, that's only you know, and it brings a smile to your face, it brings a laugh to your face, even when you think about the A-Team, or that particular person, it's the first thing that comes to mind. you might enlighten us if you have a particular story that's unique to you that still makes you chuckle even to this day.
Oh my gosh. I don't. I'm there's so many times we laughed, but I can't think of something that was that comes to mind. I mean, I remember laughing a lot all the time on the show, but something that no. Sorry, I don't. I can't think of anything. I mean, I can think of a time that that George did something that wasn't very funny. That probably wasn't, you know, George. Every day at 5:30, he finished, and no matter what. And this was our very last show, or my last show, and we were on a boat. And it took forever for the guys for the lighting guys to get the scene lit. It was taking a long, long time. And we waited and we waited and we waited. And finally, we were called to the set. They called first team, which was the actors. And the second team, the stand-ins were there for a long time waiting for the lighting to get fixed. So they call us in. It's 5:30 in the afternoon. George looks at his watch. And they took like 2 hours, I think, to get this lighting perfect. George looks at his watch. He says, "Oh, gotta go. It's 5:30. And he was gone. So it was like, oh my gosh, he could have waited. He could have just, like, you know, let them have their time. I mean, the guys worked really hard to get everything lit. But George had it in his contract that at 5, I think it was 5 or 5:30, that he was finished off the set. And so it wasn't funny, but it was kind of funny.
Marla, just one quick question that came to mind. I suppose Dirk Benedict, the face man character, he was very much a romancer on screen in terms of that sort of character. Was he very a different character off screen in terms of a ladies' man? Was he quite a family oriented? Did he keep to himself? Was he very much different than that charm, smooth operator that you saw on screen?
I honestly don't know, because I didn't spend time with him, you know, outside of work. So I didn't see that he was a womanizer at all. He was just a really nice guy, very funny guy. But he was always, you know, a good guy. I don't know if he was a womanizer. That you'll have to ask him. I don't know. I don't think so.
Marla Heasley, on that note, a pleasure talking to you today to relive your memories of your time in the A-Team between 1983 to 1984. You played 10 episodes in total, one as Cherry and season 2, episode 4, Bad Time on the Border, and the other 9 episodes as Tawnia Baker, an integral part of the A-Team. Only 2 main female leads of the A-Team. One was Melinda Kula. The other was you, Marla Heasley. Thanks for sharing your memories of your time with the A-Team. We wish you all the success with your book, a great cause, and hopefully brings help out there to who need it as well. But for the moment, Marla Heasley, take care, God bless, and stay safe.
Thank you, Jim. And thank you for having me. God bless you too, and you stay safe. Thank you. Bye-bye.